Today we shall learn about functions. A function from a set A to a set B is a rule which connects an element of B with every element of A. So, it is a rule which specifies one element of B with each element of A. So, let us see the formal definition of function. Let A and B be sets. A function or map or transformation F from A to B denoted F:A:B is a relation from A to B such that for every A belonging to A, there exists a unique B belonging to B such that A B belongs to F. If A B belongs to F, then we write F A is equal to B. So, it is a map or a transformation which is usually denoted like this, and with every element of A, you associate an element of B, a unique element of B, and this you denote as F A is equal to. And it is a particular case of a relation. Relation is ordered pairs where the first component will belong to A and second component will belong to B. Here there are some restriction on this relation which defines a function. A function F from A to B is a binary relation from A to B with a special properties that every element of A occurs as the first component of an ordered pair F. And if F A is equal to B and F A is equal to C, then B is equal to C. These two properties must be satisfied by the definition of a function. It is a particular case of a relation. Now, let us see some examples of what are functions and what are not functions. Consider two sets A and B, and A has say elements A, B. A, B, B has elements 1, 2, 3 say. Then if you say like this, this is an example of a function, and another example would be on the same sets. Here you can say F A is equal to 2 and F B is equal to. So, these are examples of functions. It represents the ordered pair of, if you represent it as a relation, it will be represented as ordered pairs. So, you will have A 2, B 3 as the ordered pairs. Every element of A will be the first component of some ordered pair, and you can have only one element with A as the first component. You cannot have something else. So, let us see some more example. If you have this like this, this is also an example of a function. This is also a function. Here F A is equal to 2, F B is also equal to 2. What are not examples of function? Look at this, the same set where A consists of two elements A and B. And B consists of three elements 1, 2, 3, A consists of two elements. Now, if I define like this, this is not an example of a function, because for B we do not have a map at all. Only A occurs as the first component of an ordered pair, for B we do not have anything. So, this is not an this is not a function. And look at this, there are two ordered pairs A1 and A2, A occurs in two ordered pairs as the first component, then also it is not a function. A is mapped down to 1 and also that is not possible, A should be mapped down to a unique element. So, this is not an example of a, this is not a function. Sometimes this is called like this, this is called a partial function, we will come to that a little bit later. So, we have two conditions, every element of A occurs as the first component of an ordered pair F, and if F A is equal to B and F A is equal to C, you cannot have two different elements B and C, B should be equal to C. Now, we can have several, actually functions you have come across in school, several function, you would have some studied continuous functions, differentiable functions and so on, from the set of real numbers to the set of real numbers, they are all examples of functions only. But here after learning relations we are looking into functions as a particular case of relation, and we will also be looking at some special properties and what are inverses of functions and things like that. For example, take the set of natural numbers to natural numbers, a function from non-negative integers to non-negative integers, we can define like this, f of x is equal to 1 if x is odd, we can define this way, and f of x is equal to x by 2 if x is even. In that case, what can you say about f of 0? F of 0 is even, so 0 by 2 is 0, f of 1 is 1 because it is odd, f of 2 is, it is even, so it is x by 2, 1, f of 3 will be, it is odd, so it is also 1, f of 4 will be 4 by 2, that is 2, and f of 5 will be 1 because it is odd, and so on. This is one example. Any graph if you take, that also represents a function, like, you know, if you take the set of real numbers, this is a real numbers, this is a real plane, and you draw a line like this, this is represents the line y is equal to x, is not it, or this represents the function f of x is equal to x. Okay. And if you take some function like this, some graph, this represents the y is equal to x squared, and this represents the function f of x is equal to x squared from the set of real numbers to the set of real numbers. Like that you can represent from real functions from real to real as a graph in the two dimensional plane. Now, you have a domain A and a codomain B. In relation, when you define a relation on A cross B, A cross B, you call A as the domain. Here also for the function also you use the same terminology, you call A as the domain and B as the codomain. And sometimes it is also called as range. B is called the codomain or the range. So, if you have a set A, another set B, what does the function f do? F is from A to B, f is from A to B, A is the domain and B is the codomain. Now, take an element A, this will be mapped down to an element f of A. Take another element B, this will be mapped on to an element f of B. FA is the image of A, FB is the image of B. You call, use the word image, image. FA is the image of A, FB is the image of B, A is the pre-image of, you can also use the word pre-image. A is the pre-image of F A and so on. Now, if I take a subset here denoted by A dash, each element of this will be mapped here, and all these images if you take, that will be a set B dash. Okay. So, you can also look at this function as mapping subsets of A into subsets of B. Function maps A into individual, each element of A into individual elements of B, but you can also look at it this way, you can look at it as mapping subsets of A into subsets of B. This is what we will consider. Now, let F be a function from A to B, and let A dash be a subset of the domain A. Then F A dash denotes a subset of B called the image of A dash under F, that is F A dash is equal to F x, x belongs to A dash. The image of the entire domain F A is called the image of the function F. I will repeat again, if you have a function F mapping A to B, then you have a subset of A dash of A, then this is mapped down to a set B dash, this A dash is mapped down to B dash is called the image of A dash under F, B dash is called the image of A dash under F. And the whole set, see, I may have this B and A. If you consider all the elements mapping on, they may be mapped down to the whole set B, or sometimes it may be a subset of B. Then this is called the image of A under F. For example, if you take these three elements and three elements here, A, B, C, 1, 2, 3, A will be mapped down to 1, suppose A, B is also mapped down to 1, C is mapped down to 2, then the image of the whole set is only 1, 2, a subset of this set. Now, let us consider some example and see, explain this concept. Suppose you have a set A is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. And B a set A B C D. So, you have something like this 1, 2, 3, 4, A B C D. A map is defined like this 2 A 3 D 4 C, like that. This is a function. Now, what can you say about F? Yeah, if you take individual element, you can say like this, F 3 is D and so on. If you take a subset, F of, what is F of 2, 3? Two is mapped down to A, 3 is mapped down to D. So, this will be A D. Okay. So, you can look at it as mapping subsets into subsets. If you take F of 1 comma 2, 1 and 2 are both mapped onto A, so you will get A. If you take the whole set 1, 2, 3, 4, then 1 and 2 are mapped onto A, 3 is mapped onto D, 4 is mapped onto C, you will get A, C. This is the image of this, this is the image of this and so on. Next, we shall consider composition of functions. You know that you can combine relations, you have composition of relations R1 and R2. If you have R1 and R2, you talk about the composition. How do you combine a function? Okay. That is the next point we will consider. Suppose you have a relation R1 from to B and R2 from B to B, I'll say A on A cross B and R2 on B cross C. Then R1, R2 specifies a relation on A cross C. And how is that defined? AC belongs to R1, R2 if there exists B belonging to B such that AB belongs to R1 and BC belongs to R2. This is how we define composition of relation. Now, how do you define functions, composition of functions? Now, let F be, let G be a function from A to B. G is a function from A to B and F is a function from B to C. Then F dot G, you can use the symbol or just sometimes just write F G. This is a composition of functions. It is defined like this. F dot G, it is from A to C. It will be a map from A to C and it is defined like this. F dot G of X is equal to F of G of X. So, if you have a function, say, I will consider like this. Now, G is from A, B, C to 1, 2, 3, something like this. And F is from 1, 2, 3. To say some x or m n p something, then 1 is mapped on to m, 2 is mapped on to n, 3 is mapped on to n, say. Then what is f dot g? It is from A to C, A to B, this is B to C. So, it is from A to C, each element you have to define and it is defined like this. So, F dot G of A is equal to F of G of A and what is that? F of, what is G of A? 1, F of 1 and what is F of 1? That is M. So, F G of A is M. F dot G of B will be F of G of B and that is F of, what is G of B? 2. So, it is 2, it is 2 is mapped on to N. What is F dot C? That is F of G of C, that is F of, what is G of C? That is 2. So, that is N. So, this composite relation will be represented by a diagram like this. A, B, C, M, N, P, F of A is, this is F dot G, F of B is N, F of C is also, it will be mapped on like this. This is known as composition of functions. Now, this is represented by a diagram known as the commutative diagram. Composition of functions is denoted, we have considered composition of functions, which to represent that we use a diagram known as the commutative diagram. How is this represented? For example, A to B you have G. G is a function which maps onto A onto B. then B to C you have a function f. Then when we combine, f dot g denotes a function from A to C. So this is denoted as f dot g. F dot g will be from B to from A to C. Please note that it is not gf, it is fg. So from A to B you have a function, from B to C you have a function f, then f dot g is marked from A to C, right. Now composition of function is a associative property. Here you must note that if you want to have this composition, g is from A to B and f is from B to C. If these are different, then you cannot talk about the compositions. In the composition of relations also, we have seen that when you want R1, R2 to be combined, then the codomain of R2 should be the same as the domain of, codomain of R1 should be the same as the domain of R2. Similarly, if you want to have the composition of functions, the domain of f should be the same as the codomain of g. The composition of function is associative. Suppose f, that is you want to show that f g h is equal to f g of h. Now h is a function from A to B, g is a function from B to C, and f is a function from C to D. In the commutative diagram, you will represent like this. From A to B, you have h. From B to C, you have g. And from C to D, you have f. Now how do you denote this? This denotes g dot h, and this denotes g dot h, and this denotes f. So this will be denoted by f of g h. The other way around, you can also look at it like this: a b c d, this is h and this is g and this is f. So if you combine these two, if you have composition of functions here, this will be f dot g, and so using this you will get this as f dot g and h. So you can see that f dot g dot h is the same as f dot g dot h, or in other words, if you have like this, say h, we have seen that h is from A to B, g is from B to C, f is from C to D. Suppose there is an element A belonging to A, such that h of A is equal to B, and there is an element C, B belongs to B, C belongs to C, D belongs to D, say, such that h of A is equal to B, and g of B is equal to C, and f of C is equal to D, say. Then you see that, what can you say about f g h of A? It will be a f g h will be from A to D. How can you define that? F g h of A will be equal to f of g h of A, and what is g h of A? F of g of h of A, and that is equal to f of g of h A is B, is equal to f of GBSC f of c equal to d. Now, the other way around, so if you consider FGH of A, what will be this? This is FG of HA, and we know that HA is B. So, this is FG of B, and what can you say about this? This is F of G of B, and what is G of B? That is C, FC is equal to D. So, for every element we can prove like that. So, FGH is equal to F of GH, or composition of functions is associative. Now, because of composition of function is associative, without any problem, if F is a function from A to A, then without any problem we can talk about F n. F 0 will be the identity function, you denote it like this, that is F of x is equal to x, you define like this. Then F 1 is F, then F 2 is F of F, and F 3 is F into F into F. Because of associativity, you can put the bracket this way or this way, it does not matter. So, without any ambiguity, you can talk about F of n. F of n plus 1 will be F of n into F, and you are able to define this because of the associative property. Consider for example, F from non-negative integers to non-negative integers, F of x is equal to x plus 1, okay. Then what can you say about x, f squared, that is f into f, that will be f into f of x, if you take x as the argument, x, f of x is x plus 1. So, that is x plus 1 plus 1 equal to x plus 2. So, f squared will represent, f squared of x will be x plus 2. You can very easily see that if you say f power k x, that will denote x plus k. This is a example where you see about the composition of functions. Now, we can talk about inductively defined function. Inductively defined functions. What are these? We have seen that a set can be defined inductively, a relation can be defined inductively. And because functions are particular cases of relations, you can also define function in an inductive manner. But when you do that, the underlying set, function is a mapping from a set A to a set B. If the underlying set A is inductively defined, then you can use inductive definition for defining a function. Let us consider some example. Take the example of a function which maps an alphabet sigma star into the set of non-negative integers, and this function defines the length of a string. Suppose f of x denotes the length of x. For example, suppose I take a sigma to be a b, a comma b comma c, then a string x to be say a b b a c a b, something like that. Then what can I say about the length of x? The length of x is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 7. So, it maps a string into an integer, a non-negative integer. This function is defined like this. How do you define this function inductively? How can you define this function in an inductive manner? First of all, you note that sigma star can be defined inductively. How do you define sigma star inductively? The basis class will be lambda belongs to sigma star, and the induction class will be if x belongs to sigma star, x belongs to sigma star, then xa belongs to sigma star for all a belonging to sigma. This is how you define the set sigma star in an inductive manner. Lambda is the empty string and x is some string. It's this lambda is a string of length 0, it's an empty string. Then if x is some string belonging to sigma star, then a is one alphabet, then xa belongs to sigma star for all a belonging to sigma. This is the induction class. This shows how to build more and more elements of the set from the basis blocks. Now, you in a set you also have the extremal class of definition, that is all the elements of the set are formed like this and no other elements are formed, or this is the smallest class which is defined in this manner. We have already seen these things. Now, knowing that this can be defined inductively like this, how can you define this function inductively? You see that the basis class you can define like this. The length of lambda, f is the length, so f of lambda I can say is 0, the length of the empty string is 0, and the induction portion you define like this. How do you define inductively these strings? If x belongs to sigma star, xa belongs to sigma star. So if f of x is equal to say some n, then f of xa will be n plus 1. This is what you want to say, or you can say in a easier way, f of xa will be f of x plus 1. Okay? You can define like this. Usually when you define a function, you need not have to define the extremal class because that is not necessary. Even though the underlying set, defining the underlying set, you need the extremal class. So, the basic building blocks are lambda here. So, f of lambda is 0 you define. Then in the induction class, from x, xa is built. So, you see that if f of x is equal to n, f of xa will be n plus 1, or you can say that f of xa will be f of x plus 1. This, like this, you can define inductively a function. Let us consider some more examples, because this is the way certain things are defined. Usually x plus, if they take the set of integers to integers, non-negative integers to non-negative integers, then x plus 1, instead of saying f of x is equal to x plus 1, you usually call it as a successor of x, s of x. X of x is equal to x plus 1, where s is the successor function, call it as a successor function. Then making use of this, you can define addition. Now, one more point I want to mention is, usually we have taken the function from a to b. Now, a could itself be a tuple, I mean a could be say, a could be like this, a 1, a 2, a n. It could be a Cartesian product of n sets. Then you define the function like this, f is from a is equal to like this. Then you say f of x 1, x 2, x n is equal to b. You define like this, where x 1 will belong to a 1, x 2 will belong to a 2, and so on. Xn will belong to An and B will belong to B. This is called an NRE function, NRE function. There are n arguments here. These n arguments are mapped onto a single argument like that. For example, if you take the sum of two integers, the sum, it is, you say 2 plus 3 is equal to 5, like that, isn't it? So this is defined like this. Sum, if you denote this by plus, plus is, it maps n cross n to n. Let us take the non-negative integers. It maps n cross n to n like this. For example, plus of 2 comma 3 is equal to 5, plus of 7 comma 12 is equal to 19, like that. How do we define this function in a inductive manner? You can make use of the successor function for this. So plus of basis class you can define like this, plus of a number x with 0 is x itself, isn't it? If you add 0 to any number, you will get x. So you can define like this. Now the induction class here will be something like this, plus of x with the successor of a number y will be equal to successor of x comma y. Or in other words, it means that if you want to add x with y plus 1, successor of y will be y plus 1. If you add like this, this is equal to saying find the sum of x y and find the successor, that is this. Okay. So this sort of a definition will be used when you define what are known as recursive functions. Recursive functions are defined using some constant functions and composition of operations and what is known as primitive recursion, bounded minimalization and so on, primitive recursive functions. These things we shall study later. But this is just to tell you how to define this function in an inductive manner. We can also see that the Fibonacci numbers are defined in this way. Another example is like this. Consider the Fibonacci numbers. It is 0, 1, f of 0 is 1, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13 and so on. That is, f of 0 is 1, f of 1 is 1, f of 2 is 2, f of 3 is 3, f of 4 is 5 and so on. In general, you find that f of n is equal to f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2. It is from natural non-negative integers to non-negative integers. This is known as the Fibonacci sequence. So you see that f of 0 is 1, f of 1 is 1, 1 plus 1 2, 1 plus 2 3, 2 plus 3 5 and so on. This is also known as a recursive definition of the function. This function is defining recursive definition. Similarly, factorial function, if you take, factorial is again from n to n. Factorial 0 is 1, factorial 1 is 1, factorial 2 is 2, factorial 3 is 6 and so on. So in general, factorial n is n into factorial n minus 1. We can define like this. This is again a recursive definition of a function. Now when a function is defined in recursively like this, to calculate that function, sometimes it will be advantageous to use a recursive procedure. You know what is meant by an iterative procedure and a recursive procedure. Factorial can be calculated both by writing a recursive routine or by an procedure which uses iteration. So usually when a function is defined in this manner recursively, you can use iteration to write a program to calculate that function, or you can use a recursive routine to calculate that function. Now sometimes we have seen that in the definition of the function, we have seen that for every element of the domain it has to be defined. You may want to relax that a little bit and say that for some elements of the domain it need not be defined. Then you call it as a partial function. Here again the other condition that each element should be mapped onto a unique element of B is there. That is, you cannot map one element of A into two different elements of B, but for some elements of A you need not define the function. You need not have the map. That is known as a partial function. Let A and B be sets. A partial function F with domain A and a codomain B is any function A dash to B where A dash is a subset of A. For any x belonging to A minus A dash, the value of fx is said to be undefined. For example, take this function take ABC 1 2 3 A to B. The function is from A to B defined in this manner. Say f of A is 1, f of B is 3, but f of C is not defined. So when we consider the function initially, we said this is not a function, this is not a total function, but it is called a partial function because for C it is not defined, but for A it is 1, for B it is 3, map is 3. So this is called a partial function. Again, partial functions also we can define composition of functions. When you have two partial functions f and g, you can talk about the composite function f dot g. That will also be a partial function. Then the composition will be associative, and other properties like that you can define. In general, the recursive functions, we shall learn about it a little bit later, they form an important class. You talk about the total recursive functions and partial recursive functions. Partial recursive functions are the functions which are exactly computed by Turing machines, and it is the class of computable functions. They are known as computable functions. That is, they are computable by what is known as a Turing machine, computable by Turing machines. Now we will consider some special properties of a function. Special properties of functions. Let f be a function f from A to B. F is surjective or onto if f of A is equal to B. F is injective, 1 to 1, if A dash, A not equal to A dash implies F A not equal to F A dash. That is, if F A is equal to A, F of A dash, then A is equal to A dash. F is bijective, 1 to 1 and onto, if F is both surjective and injective. Functions with these properties are called surjections, injections and bijections respectively. Okay, so let us consider some examples, first with finite sets and other sets we can consider. Look at this. One, two, three, from A to B. This is A and B, this is the set B. Now 1 is mapped on to 2, 2 is also mapped, 1 is mapped on to A, 2 is mapped on to A, 3 is mapped on to B. Now this is the domain, this is the codomain. Every element of the codomain is the image of some element of an element here, okay. And such a function is called a onto function or a surjective function. It is called surjective. Look at this function, say from A, B, C to say D, E, F. A is mapped on to E, B is mapped on to E, C is mapped on to F. This is a function, no doubt, but D is not the image of any element here. This is not a surjective function. This is an example of a surjective function. This is an example of a function which is not surjective because D is not the image of any function. So look at the first definition. F is surjective or onto if F of A is equal to B. Second is, if F is injective 1-to-1 if A not equal to A dash implies F A not equal to A dash. Let us consider again examples here. You have A and you have B. Suppose I have A, B, C 1, 2, 3, 4. A is mapped on to B, B is mapped on to 2, C is mapped on to 4. This is an example of a injective function because different elements should be mapped on to different elements. In that case, you say that the function is injective or 1-to-1. Look at this example. Here 1 and 2 are mapped on to the same element, so this is not an injective function. It is not an injective function because two elements are mapped on to the same element. If F A is equal to F B, then A should be equal to B. Here F 1 and F 2 are equal, but 1 and 2 are not equal. So this is an example of a function which is not injective. This is an example of a function which is injective. Now if a function is both injective and surjective, it is called a bijective function. A bijective function will be like this. Look at this function. Here 1 is mapped on to A, 2 is mapped on to B, 3 is mapped on to C. So the whole set is the image of the function. I mean, every element here is the image of some element here, so it is surjective. Different elements are mapped onto different elements, so it is injective. So this is an example of a bijective function. It is both injective and surjective. Now you must note that if you are having finite sets, a function defined between functions A and B are finite set, if A has n elements and if B also has, if it is a bijective function, both of them should have the equal number of elements. Then only different elements can be mapped onto different elements and the whole set B will also be covered. So if it is on finite sets A and B, you will have the same number of elements in A and B. Now let us consider some real functions and see what happens. Set of functions. Functions from real number to real number. Look at this. Look at this line. This is the x axis. This is the y axis. You define the function y is equal to f of x. Now this denotes y is equal to x line, or here the function is f of x is equal to x. What can you say about this function? This is different elements are mapped down to different element, so it is injective. Right, and every element is the image of some element, isn't it? If you take some number y, y will be the image, or if you take some number say P, some real number P, P is the image of P. So, it is also surjective and hence because these two are satisfied it is bijective. Now, look at the function y is equal to e power x. The graph will be like this. What can you say about this? Different elements will be mapped onto different elements. You can see that if you have x1 not equal to x2, e power x1 will not be equal to e power x2, and so different elements will be mapped onto different elements. So, it is injective, but the negative numbers are not image of any elements here. So, it is not surjective. This is an example of a function which is injective but not surjective. Look at this function y is equal to x cubed plus 2x squared, something like that. How will the graph look like? 3x squared plus 4, x should be 0, x is equal to 0, and then where will cut the x axis at minus 2, x is equal to minus 2. So, the graph will be something like this. You can see that it will be something like this. Is this an surjective function? You can see that every element will be the image, every element, for every element there will be one element for which it is the image. So, it is an example of a surjective function, but here two elements are mapped on to the same element. So, it is not injective. This is an example of a function which is surjective but not injective. And look at this function y is equal to x squared. The graph will look like this. What can you say about this function? The negative numbers are not image of any elements. So, you will find that it is not surjective. It is not surjective, and two different elements will be mapped onto the same element here. So, it is not injective. This is an example of a function which is neither surjective nor injective. So, it is not necessary that all functions should be injective or surjective or something like this. Some functions can be injective functions, some functions can be surjective functions, some functions will be bijective functions, and so on. Why should we consider this? Why, what is the necessity to consider these properties of such functions? There are something functions known as hash functions. Some functions are called hash functions, which are very useful in computer science and in compilers. For that you would rather prefer to have a bijective function. If not, you will at least have tried to have a function which is close to an injective function, and so on. We shall see this application in the next lecture.